Welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. And do you know what, people? I was on the computer the other night because there was pretty well nothing on TV. Let's face it, yeah, there's not a great deal on TV to keep you amused, is there? Mind you, I do like Wicked Tuna. Anyway, I was kicking around on the computer and I found this file. I thought, vintage. I thought we put all our vintage films up. Apparently not. I found some more. Because years ago, I used to make fishing films under the Totally Awesome Fishing, and they were on VHS tapes. Now, VHS tapes now, after about 20, 30 years, they tend to break up a bit, and you can, you know, have them sort of biodegrade or whatever they do. The plasticizing goes, and they go right peculiar. Anyway, I did pay this company to try and salvage something for me, and they did. I've lost some of the quality. The sound is rubbish, etc., etc. But at least it shows you something of what the fishing was like way back on the southwest corner of Ireland, over in County Kerry, about 25 years ago. That's a quarter of a, it's at least a quarter of a century ago, as far as I can remember. Trouble is, I remember it like yesterday. And the shocking thing is, I'm even better looking now than I was back then. Dingle in County Kerry, and Dingle Harbour itself almost completely enclosed by water. And this is a stamp of fish we used to catch there a quarter of a century ago. And this was just a late afternoon session that we were going out trying to catch some mackerel for bait for tote fishing. Can you imagine that fishing today, where you would go out and catch double finger cod like this, just feathering while you're just, you know, trying to catch some mackerel and sandhill for bait. And on top of that, over the reefs, out of Dingle Bay, nice pollock, 8, 9, 10 pounds. We came in with like half a box of pollock. I mean, the fishing in Ireland was back then, and still is now, way, way better than it is in Britain. That's for sure. A lot more species. Dingle Harbour itself has still got that commercial angle to it. It's got a lot of commercial boats there. And bear in mind, look at some of these old boats. These were trawlers and probably netters and potters from 25 years ago, I would guess. And I'll tell you what, guys, off that pier, all around there, some really, really good conger fishing. Not real monsters, but there are plenty of them. Well, you can see why, because obviously all those boats are dumping their fish over the side. Now, on the other side of the peninsula, over from Dingle, you just go around Kerry and you've got a place called Feenin in Tralee Bay. It's the other bay over the other side of the headland. Now, here's an extremely young Graham Pullen, and just showing everybody how he rigs up for tope, for skinny water tope fishing. A running ledger rig, about 6 feet of 130-pound mono leader. I don't use wire, didn't back then, and don't now. And then I use what I used to call a split tail, which was then popularised as what people call a flapper, but they don't know I started the popularity of it by calling it the split tail about 40 years ago. It's now called a flapper. Now this one is just a head and guts, but you can see I left the top and the bottom off there for extra smell. It's a running ledger rig, just a simple boom. So for tope fishing in shallow water, you can uptide, or you can just use ordinary boat gear. You can just use what you've got on the day. It really doesn't matter because it's shallow water. You can also, as well as using head, you can use a fillet. Just pop it up, point it in first over the eye or crimp of the hook, then put a fold in the bait and roll it back, pushing the point through, and look how nice and flat that lays. That is the traditional bait for shallow water for tope. That's what we use. You can, if you pull it up over the top, you don't actually need, you know, to elasticate it down. You can cast it out with a boat caster uptied, and you can see by the pitching of the boat, it was a pretty rough day. In fact, we probably shouldn't even have been out there. It's rough, it's wet, and the first customer of the day is, yes, it's Ireland, it's Tralee Bay, it has to be the dogfish. Now, this angler was fishing with me on the day. He came over, I think he won a competition, I can't remember. And he was on his first tope there with a nice sort of light up tide rod, which is what you want for shallow water tope fishing. You can see how close to shore we are, probably in no more than about 12 feet of water. I should think bouncing up and down in low water, you could probably bang the hull on the bottom of the sand on the seabed there. And I remember the old skipper there, his name was Michael Moriarty, and he was a good, well-known monkfish skipper, because where we were fishing there 30, 40, 50 years ago was an absolute prime area off the mussel beds, for monkfish. And here we go, a nice shallow water tope. Yeah, there's no need to gaff them. You can just see the back of the boat washing around. It's my rubby sack, my chum slack, sack there, and that's sending a smell down tide. And these fish just nicked in the scissors. Sometimes you can let them run for a while. Most of the time, these are packed fish. They probably average about 20, 25 pounds in Ireland. So I can't tell you what they what they're averaging now, but they used to average about 20 plus pounds when I used to go over there and do my summer and autumn shallow water tope fishing. And Michael did a lot of tagging. He uses what was then the Central Fisheries Board rotor tags, they're called, which is like cattle tags, so they punch through the cattle's ears. And they use these, and they've been doing it for many, many years. And in the Irish Fisheries Department, they got tremendous research material because they have been tagging possibly longer than anybody's been doing it in England, as far as I know. They started over there. Well, when I first went back to Ireland, they were always tagging then. So conservation should be at the forefront of every angler's mind. There's absolutely no need to kill the tope. Of course, you can eat them, and people do eat them if they're caught commercially, but I'd sooner see them let go because they are a fantastic sporting fish. Now back out of Dingle, on the other side you have Inchstrand. That yellow marks the land, and the other side, you know, that marks a peninsula of sand. The other side, and right there in the middle is a channel. You can see that one peninsula land and the other peninsula land, which is a fine bass spot there, Inchstrand. Off the end of Inchstrand, which must be nearly a mile long, there's a nice channel that feeds back into Castlemaine Harbour. In there are monkfish, but also the tope run in there to feed on the dabs and the flounders. And what we wanted to do, this was just an experiment, we figured we'd go right on the outside edge of the bar on an ebb tide, and hopefully we would get some fish that have been up in Castlemaine Harbour feeding, and they'd be running back out, and we'd catch them as they ran out. One of the beauties of fishing in Ireland is the scenery. It is the place to go. If you've never been to Ireland, I thoroughly recommend going. Of course, you do run the gauntlet of weather. In Ireland, they get all the southwest winds coming over there. Obviously, it's not called the Emerald Isle for nothing. You know, it is a lot of rain, and therefore, that's why everything is lovely and lush and green. Now, for my shallow water tope fishing, skinny water tope fishing, I call it, I used to cube up all the mackerel that the skipper used to keep for me, and I'd put them in a sawn off plastic drum like this, slide it all in there, and as much as we could get. Don't forget, back then, a quarter of a century ago, there were plenty of mackerel around. There are not now. And then I had a novel way of mashing it all up. Ha ha! I love it. Just get in there with a pair of thigh waders and stamp and mush it all up. It's a bit whiffy, you know, if it's old stuff that's in there, my goodness me. There could be a bit of an attractive aroma about it. And then I put in some Duckham's 2050. It was in the Duckham's 2050 can. I put in some pilchard oil as well. You can also use cod liver oil. And of course, we now make our own raptor oil for our own sharking use. But even for tope, because basically they're a bottom feeding shark, and the idea is to get them attracted to you. There's no question in my mind. If you can get a good smell trail of bran, oil, fish particles over the side, especially on the bottom, along the bottom, which is where they are, and you know, to avoid using gloves. Oh yeah, this look. Oh, I'm gonna have my tea in a minute. Get that stuff in there. I am telling you, I've been doing this for 50 years. If you do the chum, you will get the goods. Now there you can see the drop off on this very old sounder. Wasn't old at the time, but you can see the actual shelf of the channel off the end of Inchstrand there, where it drops down, and you can see it's just fallen away completely. Now the tope, when they run through, will generally be not right in the centre of the channel, but on the edge of the bank. And you want to anchor the boat so that you're in the edge of the bank area with the tide running out or in. Make sure that you set your reels, whether you're using lever drags or fixed balls, with a ratchet on, and some line can come off. If you leave it with a reel locked up, there's every chance when a tope grabs it, it's smash and grab, boys, you're gonna lose it. and you can amuse yourself there with nice light LEDs catching small whiting like this. Now that's what the tope are actually coming in to eat. Small fish, dabs, whiting, flounders. And here was something I have rarely seen. There was no wind and there was an absolute plague of jellyfish. Now what I want to know is, if you look at this jellyfish, it's got four of those sort of luminous lights in there, like LEDs. And this one's only got three. So why is that? What's that all about? Here you can see the oil coming off my chum sack there. I've also been using some American stuff that I used to spray in there and it went right peculiar in the water. Get those rods out. Tope do like calm water and calm weather rather than rough weather. And just look at that background scenery. It's fantastic.
Sounded a bit positive there. Are you still there? Oh, we're away, we're away. Leave her on, Dean. Where do you want him to hit it, George?
Whenever you're ready now, because I'm working, take it to the
deep. Give it something, Dean.
No!
Go under the boat.
It's all right. Just slacken the drag off
a bit. Ease a bit of drag, just a touch, a little bit. That's it.
They touch it, they run.
He's got to do an anchor rope job, this one. Ultra rope just to pass it to him. Let George walk it round.
Yeah, just give it slack.
He's still running. You go up.
With shallow water tope fishing, you definitely want to use light tackle in the rod department, not necessarily line. There's no point using really light line because these are a powerful fish. They are really basically a bottom feeding shark. So I would suggest the lightest line I'd want to use for tope would be 20 pound main line. Most of the time I'm quite happy to use a light rod, but I stick with something like 20 to 30 pound main line, at least 100, 120 pound, 130 pound trace. And here you can see George, he's got a very good high gunwale on the boat, and you have to reach over to grab those fish. No need to gaff them aboard. And again, this fish is tagged 13787 for anybody who wants to know. They can maybe look it up and see if it's even been recaptured yet. Sometimes they're caught up to 2,000 miles away, and I have one that was caught from tagged in North Devon, and it was actually caught off the coast of Spain, can you believe? That's some distance.
Oh, is this net strong enough for me to put
Yeah, we'll ball it all up and then put the scales in short. You're hanging there somewhere, I'm sure.
It's
35 pounds. 35.
35 exactly.
There you can see, that's a really sleek, superb fighting machine, that tope. Now, most of the packfish I find are male fish, but that's quite big for a male. Generally the big females are the ones that make 60 or 70 pounds. They rarely get those in Ireland, but what they do get in Ireland are big numbers of tope. You can have some fantastic sport, and when they hit you, they come to you. You might have three, four, even five rods go off at the same time, and they could all have 30, 20, 30, 40 pound fish ripping line out all over the place. If you want a big fish in shallow water, the tope is the one to get. And I even managed to hook one myself. Looks like on the uptider, I'm still using 30 years later.
Feel
all
that thing, doesn't
matter,
because we've got
any
other rods.
If you drop that rod, you're not going to be stuck.
Take him in the same corner, George.
Yeah, I'll take him in.
General way to lift hope aboard is generally you can either grab the dorsal if they're small like George is doing, or the tail and a pectoral fin which you can use to drag them aboard. That way you don't damage a fish and hopefully you don't get bitten yourself, and that's a proper way to lift the tope out. Don't gaff them.
Here we go. 32,
is it?
Okay.
I think the best day's tope fishing I had was over in Ireland. I think we hooked something like, we had about 45 runs, just three of us, in one day in shallow water about 12 feet deep on light tackle. It was one of the most amazing days fishing I've ever had. And to be honest, it's possibly still able to do it. So there you go, it gives you some sort of idea on skinny water tope fishing over in Ireland. If you ever get the chance to go, there's lots of places, anywhere from Kerry right up to Lough Swilly up in the north. Ireland, fantastic country, beautiful scenery, unbelievable fishing. Yes, the weather ain't great, but I'll tell you what it is, the fishing is worth the trip alone.